The NBA has been around for a long time and a lot of players come and go. Now usually players are forgotten history, so the best way to make your name remembered for as long as possible is usually to win a championship. Sadly, these guys weren't able to do it, but trust me and believe me, these dudes were absolute ballers. Looking back and revising on all these names makes me sit and realize that instead of hating on these players, we need to live in the moment and embrace these guys, because players come and go. There's going to be players in the league right now who won't be remembered by the next generation of basketball fans. DeMar DeRozan, Blake Griffin, Gordon Hayward, these are all amazing hoopers from this generation who could be in this list in a couple years. So make sure you use these moments to enjoy basketball. If you look at my recent videos, you can see that most of them have more views than my subscriber count. We need to change that. Join the family and hit that sub button if you like basketball content. Join the family, we're on the road to 1,000 subscribers, and enjoy the video. First off, we need to bring up Deron Williams. Deron Williams was a small point guard out of the University of Illinois. He was drafted in 2005 with Chris Paul ahead of him. Chris Paul, who's known to be one of the greatest point guards of all time. And even though Chris Paul has emerged as the better point guard of all time, there used to be legitimate conversations about who the best point guard in the NBA was between Chris Paul and Deron Williams. In head-to-head matchups, they played 25 times and Deron Williams had 17 wins to Chris Paul's 8. But even though these were conversations, CP3 was a better player. But don't get it twisted, Deron Williams was a baller. He was 6'4 and he had a nasty handle and could run the pick and roll as well as any other guard in the league. He even had a 57 point game, so he could really score that thing too. He was a 3-time All-Star, 2-time All-NBA, and had career high averages of 21 points per game, 10.7 assists, and he was always generally efficient. His early Jazz teams were always 50 win teams and they were always able to make deep playoff runs. Unfortunately, his persistent ankle injuries derailed his career, and by the time he was 32, he was out of the league. A lot of his game relied on his athleticism, and he even gained a little bit of weight, but he still had a pretty good career, and that guy could play. My last memory of Deron Williams in the league was in 2017, when the Cavs were kind of struggling, and LeBron James claimed that the Cavs needed a playmaker. So the Cavs signed Deron Williams, and he actually provided a decent role for the remainder of the season and the playoffs, but he ended up being off of the roster by the next season. Unfortunately, he couldn't really cement himself properly in the NBA history, but he still has a couple of Olympic gold medals, so that's good for him. But after retirement, he still kind of kept his name in the mix. He grew up a huge boxing and MMA fan and decided to test his luck in the ring, and he would fight NFL running back Frank Gore. He would actually go on to win that match by split decision. But nowadays, we don't really hear much from him as he's just living out the rest of his life with his wife and his 4 children. Next, Z-Bo, Memphis legend. Zach Randolph was a 6'9", 250-pound beast who played a long 8 seasons for them, and even though he was never a championship, he was so much more to that city than that. In 2010, he was traded to the Memphis Grizzlies for Quentin Richardson, and the city of Memphis actually disliked the trade. The next year, the Grizzlies finished as an 8 seed and matched up with the number 1 seeded San Antonio Spurs, and Z-Bo came out and averaged 22-11 against arguably the greatest power forward of all time. And apparently Tim Duncan couldn't stop him because the Grizzlies end up winning the series in 6 games. This was the second time in NBA history this had happened. This was the start of the Memphis grit and grind era, and Z-Bo was the heart and soul of this era. And with Memphis not having a huge winning aspect in the past, this was huge for the city, and he loved Memphis back. He always gave back on and off of the court, and he became a Memphis icon. Now let's talk about a little bit more of his on-court game. He was a low post demon, super thick, pause, and strong. This was back in the early 2010s when post scoring was still prominent, and he had career high averages of 21 points and 12 rebounds. During their whole era, the Grizzlies were always a consistent playoff team, but they could never make it past the hump. And Z-Bo was getting older, so his run in Memphis would eventually end in 2017 when the Kings would trade Z-Bo to the Kings for his final season. And me being a hip hop fan and an NBA fan, Yo Gotti rapped one of my favorite lines in rap history.
Biggest nigga ever came out the city, got it hard away. Why they trade Z-Bo to the Kings? Fucked up the team, took the city hard away.
That man was special. In 2019, he would officially retire from the NBA after a long career, and I say that to say this. Even though he may be forgotten in NBA history down the line, he won't be forgotten in Memphis because they retired his jersey, and it was the first jersey Memphis has ever retired, so he's always going to be that guy for them. Last dude I want to talk about is one of the best centers of the 2010s, and he was the sole purpose of this video. DeMarcus Cousins has been receiving a lot of attention on Twitter, and yes, I will be the first one to admit, no, he probably don't got nothing on Joel Embiid and Nikola Jokic, and the 2010s were a weaker era of centers as the NBA tried to move away from dominant centers, but he was still that guy, and I have no idea how much I can stress that. He was another bruiser just like Zach Randolph, coming in at 6'10", 270. He had Joel Embiid-like strength. He could shoot it, pass it, and even playmake a little bit. Even though he turned the ball over a little bit more than you would like your center to, he was still bringing the ball up the court for teams like Sacramento and New Orleans. A lot of people like to sit there and talk about the fact he can never make the playoffs, but it seems like people forget to remember that you need a quality basketball team around you to be able to compete. In Sacramento, his best teammates were Rudy Gay and Darren Collison. What do you expect him to do with that roster? Despite all that, he still averaged highs of 27, 11, and 5. He used to terrorize centers around the NBA. When Boogie got traded to New Orleans, him and Anthony Davis were an unstoppable duo. They won 48 games while both putting up insane numbers, and they breached the playoff spot. But unfortunately, he tore his ACL in the middle of the season, and that permanently affected his play. And he eventually found himself out of the league after bouncing around some franchises. But now he's playing in the Puerto Rican league, and he's still hooping, and that's always a good thing to hear. He was a two-time Olympic gold medal winner, four-time All-Star, and two-time All-NBA. So he was able to stack up a solid resume. I just wish he was able to find more success winning-wise during his prime. But the disrespect for DeMarcus Cousins needs to stop. Because let me tell y'all, in that 2015, 16, 17 era, he was that guy. He was doing people dirty. He was the best center in the league. Let's respect this man a little bit. But that's it for the 2010 Most Forgotten Players. If there's anybody I forgot or anybody that you want to point out, let me know in the comment section. And if you want to see me do a 2000 edition, let me know as well. Put names of guys that you would like to see in that video in the comment section. Make sure you comment, like, subscribe, join the family. We're on the road to 1,000 subscribers. And don't forget, man, enjoy the game. Stop hating on these guys so much and just enjoy the game. But like I said, make sure you support the channel. And I'm out, man. Peace.